dump it all the way, and then the machine will kick it out when it's on. This is loading position. And then when it's shut, itself. And this we dry mix our clay. The clay can be put in here dry. With water in here. This allows us to change batches of clay also. And we're getting ready for another firing. This is a bisque load going in. We're putting our clay in a Bluebird 440 vacuum pug mill. And that gives us a 3-inch extrusion. That are spaced 1.5 inches, 2 inches apart, and that way we can cut, we don't have to remember what the weights are on the machine. Then the clay is rolled up and stored for Bluebird. Actually, it's quite efficient, even as small a machine as it is. Still give us a lot of clay per hour. And then it doesn't take up much space.
This is what you do when you potty. Okay. Drink some water and go over here.
If you're going to talk American so we can understand you.
I mean, you stick your fingers.
I like water in my eyes.
You stick your fingers in here. Oops.
Years?
No months.
See, you make a pot. Beer stein.
And this is that's salad bowl. Now, this is the fucking table. And this is where you wash your hands after pottery. And this is the one for us. And this is what his grandchildren made. And here, is it these things? And then, follow me.
have to burp.
Don't touch any.
You burn your pot.
Fire. The term is fire.
Fire and all his pottery's in there, and he has to burn it before he can paint it.
Fire it.
Fire it. And in this brick, there's a little cookie thing like this. I mean, a bin.
That's called a cone.
Cone.
Hold it up.
And when it bends over, you know it's done. Okay? Right. We shall bring you into Heather's pottery now. Come on. And she is trying to pottery, which is okay.
Solid. Okay? On my hand.
And see her hand. Ooh. See her hands?
Don't see.
In the last firing, fairly heavy reduction, got a nice brown glaze. I don't know if I'm satisfied with this firing.
We're recording.
Okay, this is a cone plaque gloss firing, and it was a cone 10 bending. This is the cone 10, and it was put in as a guard cone so that we didn't go further than that, or if we did, we would know how much further. This is cone 9 down here. That was the temperature that the glazes and the clay mature at. This is cone 8. It was a warning cone, and then on the other side here, we have a cone 6, and then there was a cone 4, and then 04 or 04 and 06. All of the glob in this little reservoir right here is the melted cone plaque. These are made out of ceramic material that have a predetermined melting rate, and it's much more accurate than a pyrometer, because it as they melt, they also indicate when your clay is maturing. Now, to make the cone plaque, now we'll take just a small piece of clay. We're going to make a plaque or two plaques for a bisque firing, so we don't need as big a plaque. I'm only going to put in two cones, an 09, which melts first when it has a zero in front of it, when the numbers have a zero in front of it. Now this one's broken at the tip, so that's no good. We don't discard those. When it has a zero in front of the number, the higher the number, the lower the temperature. And when it's a plain number, then it's just the opposite. So I have cone 09 and cone 07. I want this bisque to mature at cone 07. We're using Orton cones, which is an American potter's standard pyrometric material. The other one is the English use what they call Seeger cones. They both do the same thing. There's a little bit different reading. The 09 is going down first, so we'll push this 09 in the front part, so when it melts, it won't melt over. Now these cones are made little triangles, and they also have an angle at the bottom of the cone. So when you set it flat on the table, it sits at an angle. And that's the angle you want to put it into the piece of clay. And we'll put in 07 behind it. So when 09 goes down, we know when we're approaching that in maybe 20 minutes, then we'll hit 07. We'll make up two of those. And I put one in the top of the kiln and one towards the bottom, so I know if my kiln is firing even or not. Check. Now the numbers will usually end up on the right side. You can see the numbers are on the cones. It doesn't pay, however, to get them mixed up, because they look like some color code them. Some are white, and some are purple, and some are the brown color. Now we're going to stick these in the kiln right away. So I'm going to pierce them with this pin, and that will let all of the moisture in the clay out, and this little chunk of clay plaque
then won't explode in the kiln and go flying around like popcorn. Make sure that they're even so that when we look in the kiln, we know they're not melting or we don't make premature judgments. If we put one in a little bit different angle, it may look, in the heat, it may look like it's starting to bend, and then we might increase or decrease our kiln prematurely. Okay, these are ready then to put in the right. We'll make some lids. There's some different kinds of lids. This lid is thrown, these are all thrown off the hump. This one is thrown all in one piece by opening the clay on the side and then opening it in the center, and then calipered, but it's thrown off a hump of clay. One reason for a lid like this is that the center of gravity is low and the handle is high, so that it will stay in place when it's put into the pot. This is another example of the same thing. This was thrown like this off the hump into a taper, so it fits into a tapered jug, and then the top was thrown on after this became leather dry. We have a couple of lids here now for these ramekins that were thrown as dishes. They were thrown off the hump in much that fashion. So now we'll fasten them down to the kiln, or down to the wheel, and get them centered, and then tap them down so they stick to the wheel head. And we'll take off this excess, and we're going to throw just a simple knob on these, and the center of gravity will be high. They're concave over the pot, leaving more room inside the pot. Where the other lids would sit down in like this, it wouldn't be advisable because you'd be cooking food in here and you need all of the space you can. So a domed lid over this would be, and since you're not pouring or you're carrying this straight usually with food in it, the center of gravity then can be up in here. This is a parapitter loop tool that I'm carving with. There are several different kinds of carving tools: L-shaped, pointed, spade, with spade ends and pointed ends that you can use. But I think I learned with this, and I guess that's why I'm using it. Not necessarily the best tool or the only tool you can use. We'll carve all the excess clay away, and hoping we don't carve too deep because that's still fairly soft, just a little past leather dry. And I'm using a piece of hardware cloth and leave the little sharp ends. It makes a nice scoring tool. So we score the top of that, and with a toothbrush, put a little water in it and take a ball of clay. And roll it into a ball. And I pound a little concave surface in here that will make the clay squooge out as I push down on it. Make sure that it's going to stay on the lid and doesn't crack off afterwards. And lubricate a little bit, and I will center that little piece of clay in there. Make sure it's joined to the lid. Overlap it, and then undercut it with your finger. Make a smooth transition, and make the lid a little bit wider so it can be grabbed with an oven mitten. And then the lid is finished. We have a knob now that we're putting on it. And we'll hope that this comes loose. Didn't want to break it. It's still pretty soft, so that'd be pretty tender. pretty tender when you get all the flakes off. And then we can put it on the lid to dry. Once they're leather dry, they won't stick together. But drying together will keep them in round. I'm going to make sure that it's seated right in the center. And we have our ramekin ready to dry and then go into the bisque. We'll try one more of those. I'm going to shut it off. Put the second lid on. We'll dampen the wheel head. And then center. Leather dry, just a little bit softer than leather dye. And once again, we'll score it with this piece of hardware cloth and drop some slippy water in there, not too much, otherwise that your little clay ball will sliding off. And attach that little ball to the pot, lubricate it just a little bit so it isn't sticky, and then with a downward motion, your center, and then join it on right down at the bottom, and we'll center the rest of it, and then push the top, start from the center, keep working the top out.
Okay.
Want to come in on that now?
I did.
And make sure you don't have a turned up lid. And undercut that a little bit so you can grab a hold of the knob with the with an oven mitt. And that's it. You take it off the wheel. That pot dries. And these are the rest of the ramekins ready to dry. Okay, this is the next biscuit load, ready to go into the kiln. And then we move more pots out for drying. Got the cones in place in the kiln. This is the topmost one. The two cones for firing. That brick can be pulled out. And this shows the configuration of the bag wall. The flame comes behind these bricks. And there's space for them to come out. Here we've got more pots that are ready to dry. These are going to be beer mugs. Right now they're just cylinders. And they're large salad bowls. We're going to get looped handles over there. And then French onion soup bowls. Little round things there. And those are the handles. And so I'll throw them separately and then these get attached. And Schultz speakers with a carved graffiti design in them. the covers there.
Year I've ever heard you say that.
Well, our kiln molds have been coming out good. We haven't been losing pots like we were last year.
We're going to reduce the load.
Made a good reduction. Everything came out good on this one. A little bit light in the center. Nice. Wet wafer, just a little nice reduction. This is what he was talking about in the color. Center, so I've got to cut the secondary air down.
That picture is beautiful.
Yeah, isn't that nice?
That's a $14 one. And there's nothing wrong with this one. It didn't get a real heavy reduction. But...
Scratch it. It's going to make a mark there. Or we need a demonstrator. Well, these are the matches that were wet. Of the internationally famous carp cups. Made in Minnesota by Minnesotans for Minnesota. Exaggerated handles on these will shrink smaller. This handle shrinks a lot. This is my gas car kiln. The cart being out now and resting on tracks. The kiln is loaded and then pushed into the kiln itself. There are two burners on this side. and two burners of the same on the other side. It's an arch kiln backed up with a layer of kale wool. This is a bluebird pug mill, which happens to be closed at the moment. And a Scut 1027 kiln with the timer and automatic shutoffs on the south side. And the stack and goes up through the roof. What do you think of them, Anna? Huh? You like them?
Mom, they're here. Oh, you hate us.
Or something, so we don't have to be running back to the house. That turned out beautiful on your squeezers. Good reduction in water. You know, we got a nice green on this oatmeal glaze this time too. See, we're starting early enough.
Starting
these turn out
early,
just,
what?
Even where they went back.
Oh,
down.
Yeah. That's kind of neat, isn't
kinda
it?
Kind of different, isn't it? Can I get the legs off? Look at the clay.
Yeah, that's really neat.
Can I turn on that?
Yeah.
Maybe we should do more of that.
Well,
they're
let's
old,
see,
look
those
like they're open.
Yeah, I think they look like it in.
Yeah.
These we should leave. We need a place to put them.
That's a nice cheap one. I like the handle.
Yeah. I like that.
Well, they're still a little too wet to trim some coffee tops, coffee pots. These are ready to trim. And the filter tops for them, those will pop off the bat. Over here we got pots drying. Vern is moving them out into the other room to dry completely. The bean pots right there, and the things with the holes in them are water candles. Fill them with water and then float a candle in the top of them. Now we got a pan of wax over there and just dip the bottoms in. It helps facilitate the wiping the glaze off on the bottom. Two glazes dipped in a white dolomite glaze and then in an iron glaze. They've all been bisfired to cone 07. Pots on the table have been glazed once. The lids have been waxed and the inside of the rims have been waxed, so they don't stay together. And then the bottoms are wiped off, so that no glaze residue sticks on them. Otherwise that'll fuse right to the kiln shelf. And these pots are being wiped. Just use an alcohol sponge and water just to wipe them down. We're going to dip the rest of the bottom of the bean pots now in the iron bearing glaze.
And the glaze sets up very quickly, but I'm going to stir in the buckets every time you dip your pots in. You want to stir them up. This pot's already been glazed inside and outside, and it dried the touch. They dry very quickly. And it's dipped in up to the line, just a little bit overlapping on the bottom. And you can see how fast they dry. That one's ready to be wiped. And retreat the process. One of these. The bisqueware is very porous, so the water in the glaze is soaked up or sponged up very, very quickly. Now what we're going to do here is to glaze the inside with the iron bearing clay, and then fill it in. We don't want to spill too much. We do want to maybe just a little bit of a line down here. And then we'll do the glaze all around the edge. And then we'll dip it partially, only that high.
And the glaze has to come off of both parts of the lid. These are fired together. The lids are always fired on the pots in a reduction fire. In case there's any warping, the lid will help keep the opening round and also, if it does warp, it'll warp with it so that you've got a lid that fits. Can't be any glaze at all on the foot or on the rim. Even down into the little groove. Each pot has to be wiped. It's time consuming, but if you leave one little drop of glaze, the lid will fuse on and you have a sculpture piece, because you would surely break the lid before you got it off.